10 minutes presentation on the automatic calibration algorithm that we will be using them in two applications. One is today for the fitting of the semivariogram, because it's an optimization problem in which we want to estimate the parameters of the semivariogram, and we want to find the optimal parameters that provide you the best fitting of the semivariance, which is experimental. And then it will be used also in the next days when we want to estimate the parameters of the rainfall runoff model, and how fitting the model result to the measured stream flow data, to the measured discharge data. So you already have probably known something about genetic algorithms and heuristic optimizations. So those methods are different from traditional mathematical methods that estimate an optimal, that find a minimum or a maximum, because they don't do any hypothesis on the function that you are going to optimize. So most of you probably know these things, but just for the one who are not completely familiar with them, here, heuristic or meta-heuristic algorithms doesn't require, for example, the continuity of the or that your objective function has to be differentiable and continuous and things like that. So those kinds of algorithms completely fit the optimization problem that have a lot of parameters and have irregular function that has to be optimized. In general, we speak about monorm-objective calibration, but what it is? We have a reality, which is this, the stream flow, for example, that we measure in reality, or the observed experimental variance, and we have models. And what if we pick parameters for a given model, we have a distance, which are the black lines between your model at the discharge or snow water equivalent or time series and your reality. And of course, this distance depends not only on the parameters of your model, but depends also on the model structure. For example, we have model with different complexity. If we speak about rainfall runoff model, we have lumped model, we have semi-distributed models, and fully distributed models. And as you can see, the black arrow it's theoretically shorted for a fully distributed model because they take in account all physics of the problem and things like that. Whereas the black arrows are larger for lambda model because they make more approximation of the reality. But what in general a calibration procedure does is to reduce or make minimum the distance between the reality and the observed values, for example stream flow, given a model structure and given a parameter set. So you will see that after the calibration, from the black arrows, you move to the red one. So and you can also see that calibration reduce, so make it minimum the distance between the models and the reality. Of course, those red arrows will be shorter also for fully distributed model and a little bit larger for other models that make more approximation on the processes that we are going to model. So this is not a course on calibration, but just to have an idea of what we will do. In general, optimization algorithms are constituted by two ingredients. The first one is the objective function that has to be optimized, and the second one is the optimization algorithms, that is the strategy in which we search the in the parameter space in order to get a minimum or an optimization of our objective function. Is it more or less clear up to here? Do you have questions? Most of you probably already faced this problem, and it's just to yes, be on the same page when speak about optimization function and optimization strategy. So in UA, in GeoFrame, we have implemented different optimization functions, and those functions are just a measure between the reality and the model output. So you can see that we have many. Here I reported just a few. Probably most of you are familiar with root mean square error or Nash-Sutcliffe. And one question could be, okay, but why we need all these functions? Isn't just enough one of those? One can say yes, but at the end, each of these functions focus on some specific quality of your objective. So, for example, if your objective is to simulate the peak flow discharge, probably there are specific objective functions such as the Nash-Sutcliffe for these FHF objective function that specifically aims to help you in fitting the peak of your time series. But then, instead, sometimes you are interested to conserve the whole mass of your simulation, the mass of water or whatever, and then you can use, for example, p-bias or Klingupta efficiency, for example. And again, on Klingupta, you can see that this accounts for different aspects of your time series, of your comparison. And for example, Klingupta wants taking account of three different aspects, which is the differences between the mean values of your simulated and observed value, the variance, and the correlation coefficient. So Klingupta is a sort of multi-objective calibration because we are looking at three different aspects of our comparison. The second ingredient is the optimization algorithm, and recently have been developed different kinds of those algorithms, and still the literature right now is providing more and more solutions, especially in the field of artificial intelligence. And these, those are like one of the most common, let's say, optimization algorithm, which is Amalgam, for example, implemented by, presented by Jasper Fruit, which is one very big guy of the optimization problems. And we will see Particle Swarm, but there is also another one, which is probably the first heuristic algorithm that has been applied in hydrology, the Shuffled Complex Evolution. Among all these three, we will focus on just one for now, the particle swarm optimization, and then we will see that LUCA, which is acronym of Let Us Calibrate, we will use the Tiburon Shuffled Complex Evolution in its core. Why I'm speaking about those two? Because those two are already implemented in object modeling system, in OMS, and then you can use it. So I'm already there to use it. For example, when I start, Particle Swarm was not there, so I would want that implemented Particle Swarm in the OMS, but if you need another one, you can also implement it. So, you can use what is there, but you can also extend according to your specific needs. So, Particle Swarm is this is a very simple and quite well-known slide on how to introduce Particle Swarm to student and PhD students, is an example of cooperation. Why? Because particle form was presented with the objective to simulate social behavior, so it was not it was born in this field, and in particular to simulate the flight of the birds and also how fish moves in the ocean and so on. So the idea is here in the example is to give a visual expression of or of how particle swarm works, and then we will find an analogous of what you see in exactly mathematical form. So first we will try to understand, and then we will see the equation. So the objective is to try to fish this fish or save it, which is in the bottom part of this lake, and to do this, we have two people that are looking for it, okay? And here, what we want to underline, to stress, is the cooperation between these two fishermen. So what they do is that they try to see with the dorsal row if the fish is there, or how deep is the fond. And so they try for the first step. And they see that more or less the fondal is the same for both. So they go home. And then you will see that at the next time step, the blue one is deeper than the green one. And so the blue one tell to the green one, please come faster in my direction because I found a deeper place there. In fact, we will see that we are seeing that this distance is larger than this one. So at the next iteration, the green fisherman will move faster in the direction of the blue one. Why faster? Because the blue one has reached a deeper part of the fond. And then the blue one at the third iteration is going even deeper. And then at the next iteration, the improvement of the blue one is not as much as it was in the previous step, no? Because the improvement of the blue one is a little bit lower. So what the green one does is to move towards the blue one, but with a less velocity. Why? Because the improvement was not as big as the previous one. And in fact, the distance is between the previous step and the current step of the green one is a little bit less respect to this step. Is this clear, more or less, or not? Okay. And then they can, when the blue arrives to the fish, then the green one moves really, really faster in that direction. It means that the fish was saved. But not only. We have here, as I was telling you, all the ingredients for implementing the particle work. We have the parameter space, which is the fundal, no? And it is the surface, or the fundal of this example, and it is our objective function, let's say. Then we have the fishermen that are the particles, which explore your parameter space. And then we have the velocity, which is an important parameter that tells you of how much the fishermen or the particles moves in your parameter space when they try to explore it. And those, of course, depends on the fit, the objective function, and on the improvements that we are reaching step by step. And finally, we have the objective function, which is the distances between the fisherman and the fundal, which is this line here, and we want to maximize it in our problem, okay, or minimize it if we look at the other way around. So here are all the ingredients that we need, and you don't see anything about the implementation of the first program, about the mathematical formulation, because it's already embedded in OMS. So you just knows that you just know the ingredient, the terms that we have you have to specify. For example, it will take as input the number of particles, which are, you can imagine it as the number of fishermen that they explore your parameter space. What it needs more? It needs an objective function, which is the measure that used to quantify the distances between the reality and the modeled data, and so on. So, okay. Like this, and so here are all the mathematical is the mathematical formulation of the particle swarm, and you can see here that the important terms is depend on how much we move at the next iteration, and this depends on the velocities, and those velocities which are this v are function of what? Of three terms. Of the personal influence, which is how much the each fisherman itself has improved the objective function. Of the social influence, which means, for example, the social influence for the green fisherman is the blue fisherman, which is the one that go deeper and deeper. So it is the best, let's say. And so also the social influence is accounted in particle swarm. And then there is an inertia term that accounts for just random terms in your velocity. All these things helps you to avoid to fall in local minima or maxima that are the are things where we don't want to fall down, because it's just not the optimal, but as a suboptimal parameter space. And so, yes, I will go very fast here. So the idea is to just initialize your particles and the velocity vector, and then you run for each particles, which means a parameter set, you run your model, you compute your fitness, which means your Nash-Sutcliffe or root mean square error, whatever you want, and then you compare your the fitness of each particle among them and see what is the best inside the group of particles, and update the velocities of each particle account all the information we have seen. Finally, we stop when we reach a stopping criteria that could be, for example, the amount of improvement of your objective function is not anymore significant, or that will be a maximum number of iterations, and those are the two things that we implemented in OMS. Okay, of course there are many more type of particle swarm optimization. For example, there is and all of these variation accounts for a different way to compare the particle each other. So you can compare the particles, all the world particles, or just the neighbor particles, for example, and so on. Okay. Do we have question up to here? No one? We will finish the... so we will go faster with Luca, and then we finish this. So Luca is acronym of Let Us Calibrate, and is based on the Shafer complex evolution, which is the analogous of the particle swarm. So it's just a method for searching, a genetic algorithm for searching in your parameter space. But two things are important in Luca, which are the steps and the lines. What are steps? The steps is the optimization and then the selection of the optimal parameters from a given distribution that you provide as input. The rounds are more steps executed for each time. So if Luca has been applied, for example, in deeper in for a hydrological model, for example, for the PRMS model, which is made by different processes. So you have the snow melting processes, you have the evapotranspiration processes, you have the discharge processes. And that's why steps and rounds are introduced. So if you see here, we will start with the initialization of your genes in this case, which are because are genetic algorithms, and Luca performs one step at a time. One step for you can be one process that you want to optimize. For example, we start with optimizing the parameters of the evapotranspiration, and we just compare the model evapotranspiration with the measured evapotranspiration. Then we find an optimal parameters for the evapotranspiration processes. Then you move to the next step that could be, for example, the rainfall runoff modeling, and you keep constant and equal to the optimal parameters the evapotranspiration that you have determined to the previous step. And then you calibrate the, I don't know, the routing parameters, which are specific for the rainfall runoff model. And in this case, you reduce the number of parameters that you calibrate for each time, because the evapotranspiration one are kept constant in the previous step. So you can do many steps. And when you finish the number of steps you have implemented, you can repeat the same procedure for many rounds, which means for many other iterations. You can stop when the result between two different steps are quite similar. It means that you arrive to a stable solution, to a stable parameter set. Yes. So this is more or less everything here. And then I want to say that if you run one step and one round, so you just stop here, you execute one shuffled complex evolution, whereas the number of shuffled complex evolution that runs, it depends on the number of steps that you perform. Again, what is shuffled complex evolution is just another optimization method, which is quite similar in the concept to particle swarm, but it differs because it considers the gene mutation and so on. So this is everything for the particle swarm and Luca, and we will apply particle swarm today, whereas Luca will be applied tomorrow or in the next few days for the rainfall runoff. Okay.
Are we
going to
get the presentation?
Yes.